Yes, hello, 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 ladies and gentlemen. I am super happy to welcome you back for our second recruitment webinar in the series, The Art of Recruitment. 2022 can start off with a better guest speaker than Tamar van Herk. And before I introduce Tamar, let me first tell you a little bit more about how this works again. If you have any questions, just type them in the chat. We try to make this as interactive as possible. When Tamar speaks, she can't actually see the questions, but I will make sure that if your questions are burning hot, I will interrupt her and we can have a dialogue. Or, you know, if they can save for later, I will save them up for later. Please feel free to connect with other people in the chat. You know, this is a community of recruiters for recruiters. So share your LinkedIn in details and connect with anyone that's there in the chat. If you have any lessons that you've learned and that you want to share, also feel free to share them. Because also Tamar said that she would love to learn from our audience today. Personally, me, I'm Adrian. I'm the co-founder and CEO of Matcher. Super happy that we have Tamar today as a guest. Tamar will address her lessons learned on how to scale an organization, and she has a lot of experience in fast-growing companies. To give a little bit of background about Tamar, Tamar started her career in recruitment, quite quickly joined Travelbird, a very fast-growing scale-up in the Netherlands in the travel industry. Then after Travelbird, she joined Improbable as a talent partner, then did leadership recruitment at Facebook, switched jobs to go to Uber, where she was a senior tech recruiter, and currently works as the talent acquisition lead for tech at Molly. Molly is one of the fastest growing fintech companies in Europe. I just asked Tamar when she started. She was the first recruiter that joined a year and a half ago. Currently, her team is 16 recruiters. When she started, there were 150 people in Molly, and currently they are over 700 people. So in a year and a half time, Tamar has seen a lot, and she's super excited to share experience with us. Tamar, we've worked together in the past. It was always an absolute pleasure to work with you. I'm super excited to welcome you today. Thanks for being here. And yeah, the floor is yours, Tamar.
Thank you so much. And thank you for the lovely intro, Adrian. Let me share my screen now and let me know if everyone can see this.
Yes, perfect.
Top. First of all, Happy New Year, everyone. I hope everyone had a lovely festive break. As Adrian just mentioned, today I'm going to talk about how to successfully scale your organization. And more specifically, to tell you about my lessons learned having worked in multiple high growth companies. When I was preparing for this presentation, I initially wanted to talk about my mistakes, but that list was so long. So I am sticking to my lessons learned for now, but we'll definitely cover some of these mistakes along the way. Again, as Adrian just mentioned, I'm happy to answer any questions that you may have. And I'm also curious that after this presentation, if you want to share any learnings, because I know there are many more to share them after. As Adrian mentioned, I'm currently working at Molly as their tech TA lead. For the people who don't know Molly, Molly is one of the fastest growing fintech companies in Europe. Our mission is to become the most loved financial services provider for small to medium-sized businesses in the world. And we were founded back in 2004. So we've been around for quite some time, but actually since the past 2 years, we've been through a very rapid growth phase. This had multiple reasons, but one of them was that we went in a very short period of time from Series A in mid-2019 through to Series C in 2021. But what does an investment like this mean for an organization? This had a massive impact on our growth and also an immense increase in complexity. We grew our headcount from like 250 to 300 last year to over 700 currently, including contractors. And next to that, we needed to diversify our location strategy in order to attract more talent faster. So last year, we opened two brand new offices. One is in Maastricht, which is in the south of the Netherlands. And this is our center of excellence. So we have our operations team there. And we opened a brand new tech hub in Lisbon. So currently, we have 8 offices spread across Europe. So these numbers look very kind of like impressive, but also a bit daunting at the same time, because where do you start when you need to more than double or even triple your organization? So let's start with my lesson learned number one. Build the fundamentals. So before growing your organization, it's important to first take a closer look at the current state of your company. Is your organization ready for this growth? Scalability is all about capacity and capability. What is important is to first evaluate and plan for capacity, and then take a closer look if your tools and teams are able to accommodate for that growth. Scaling your organization requires planning, processes, technology, and also partners. So let me first dive deeper into evaluate and plan for capacity. First, evaluation. You can't do anything differently if you don't know where your company stands today. What does the current organizational structure look like? Where do you want to be in 6 months? But also, how does the company need to look like in 12 months? Who do we need in order to achieve that? And another important question to ask is, when do we need them? Remember, prioritization is key here. As some of you might recognize, is that when you're planning for capacity and you have headcount planning meetings with your hiring managers, all of the hiring managers want people yesterday, and every role is high priority. To give you an example, at Molly, they try to squeeze in all hires for a whole year in H1, which of course is unrealistic because the TA team is definitely not staffed to deliver all the hires of one whole year in only 6 months. So key here is to manage expectations with the business and to build an overview of who is needed when and where. Which of these hires are prio and which of these hires can move to a later time in the year to H2. So next to that, don't forget to calculate for attrition as well. There will always be people leaving, so it's good to calculate for that. So as you can see on this slide, this is an example of how a capacity plan can look like. It gives an overview of how much time it will cost from the business to get all those hires in. So as you can see here at Molly, our interview process is scattered out over different stages, and the business gets involved in interviewing during our on-site stage. If you create a plan like this, make sure that you calculate backwards from the endpoint. So at Molly, we needed to hire 100 engineers in H1. So that will be your start point. If you know your offer acceptance rate is 75%, it means you need to offer 133 people to get to those 100 hires. One tip I would like to give here is to always double check your maths, and especially when presenting this plan to engineers. They love the maths and they love the details. So the moment that they cannot find any mistake in my calculations, I promise you I will eat my shoe. And this is a Dutch saying, and this will of course never happen, I think. But the most important thing the business wants to know is, what time does it take me to get all those hires in? So going one column back, as you can see in the plan, we need 333 on-sites to get to those 100 hires. And because we have three different interviews during that stage, it takes the business 999 hours to get to those 100 people. 999 hours is the same as 125 days or 25 weeks of full-time interviewing. And this is even excluding the time to prepare, attend the brief sessions, and any other preparation needed. So make sure the business is aware of their time investment, calculate how many interviewers you need, and how many interviews they need to conduct on a weekly basis in order to get to those 100 hires. No worries if your organization doesn't have insights into their conversion rates, because you can use generic conversion rates to calculate for capacity. As mentioned before, when building the fundamentals, next to evaluation and planning, tooling and automation are key. But first, evaluate again the current state of your tools and automation processes. Do you have the right tools and automation in place to scale your business? tooling and automation are really important in a rapid growth phase. So one of the reasons why is that it can reduce the amount of time from the business to interview candidates tremendously. To give you an example, is that when I worked for Improbable, but also currently at Molly, we decided to implement a tool called HackerRank. I am sure many of you know this tool, but for the people who haven't heard of it, it's an automated tool to help assessing technical skills of candidates. At Molly, it saved the business more than 1,000 hours of interviewing and preparation time by replacing our first interview stage with an automated tool like HackerRank. So 1,000 hours is more than 125 days, so that saved the business a lot of time. Besides HackerRank, you have a lot of other tools you can choose from to automate some of your processes. Some examples are Codility or CodeSignal, and it depends on your organization and needs what tool will fit the best eventually. And next to that, always keep on exploring new tools. The world is evolving so quickly, so make sure that you and your TA team are always looking for new ways to improve as well. Secondly, tooling and automation can also help to increase the quality and consistency in your recruitment processes. It can help to reduce bias, and it makes sure every candidate is evaluated in the same way. And last but not least, tools are really helpful to measure your success or to give you insights on what to improve. Make sure you implement them properly to get the right data out of them, and also make sure that the team is using the tools in the same way. So besides tools to help automate processes, a good ATS system is also crucial to manage all of your candidates and also to measure the success. So at Molly at the moment, we use Lever, but I also have experience using Greenhouse in the past, which I also loved. So remember, when building your fundamentals, to evaluate and plan, and to see where you can automate and implement tools to measure your success. Having said that, these are just some things to think of, but there are so many more things when you're going through rapid growth, which brings me to my second lesson learned. Don't be a perfectionist. Everyone makes mistakes. I don't know if some people here in the audience recognize this, but I made the mistake coming from big tech companies and moving to scale ups to copy those recruitment processes and ways of working. Thankfully, I realized super quickly that scale ups don't have the infrastructure of all those big tech companies. They don't have enough interviewer capacity, the right support, incredible training possibilities, and the right tooling to support those processes. So when scaling your teams, you really need to let go of perfectionism. You need to treat your TA organization like an engineering team, where shipping is key. So you need to build in a process, ship it, iterate, and improve. Making the right hiring decision is leading here. But how are you going to make the right hiring decision when you are going through such massive growth? And believe me, there will always be some people who turn out not to be a fit, but key here is to reduce that amount to a minimum eventually. And there are three basic things that are important here. So number one, if you want to make the right hiring decision, it is crucial to design a structured and scalable process. Again, remember that you can't be a perfectionist here, but you need to make sure you reduce the amount of bias in your hiring decision. So on this slide, you can see an example of a process that we implemented for software engineers at Molly. And as you can see, we have an on-site stage where we have three different interviews. So we prefer to have them in one day in order to reduce the time to hire. But to give you another example of my time at Improbable, we had six different interviews during that on-site stage. Interviewer capacity was never an issue there, so this allowed us as well to conduct more in-depth assessments of candidates. So remember that every organization is differently, and think about what is important in your organization. Is that interviewer capacity? Do you have enough? Is it speed or something else? And based on those findings, how would you design and implement your process? And remember again here, build something, ship it, iterate, and then improve, because you can't be a perfectionist. Most important things when designing such a scalable process is that if you want to hire loads of people in a short amount of time, everything needs to run as a machine. So you need to build a process that is structured, and a process where most interviewers are replaceable. And lastly, not only think of how you assess, but also what you are assessing. At Mouly, we created a whole interviewer guide on how to conduct all these technical interviews that we are assessing during the on-site. But eventually, when testing it, interviewers really needed guides to make sure they knew what to look for as well. And specifically, for example, what do we expect from junior engineers in comparison to senior engineers in this specific interview? So make sure your interviewers know how to assess and what to assess eventually. So if you have all these things in place, the next step is to train your interviewers. Training people is extremely important. Everyone in the organization needs to be trained, from senior stakeholders to junior assistant. Training the whole organization creates structure and consistency. It reduces bias. It creates a high quality process. And last but not least, it improves the overall candidate experience. But how to set up an interview training program for your organization? Well, my advice is to start with the basics first. So at Improbable, but also at Mouly, we started with basic interviewing training 1.0. And in this training, we dove deeper into the structure of the interview, but also behavioral and situational questions and legal implications. Know that a lot of people are not aware of these legal restrictions and things they cannot ask during interviews. So make sure you cover this in this training. And as you skill and get better, implement more advanced trainings. Again, build, ship, iterate, and improve. At Mouly, to give you an example, we implemented an unconscious bias training as training 2.0. And the aim of this training is to make people aware of their biases and make them feel comfortable speaking up when noticing bias in the process. So every organization is also different and has different needs. So based on that, design a proper training program for all your employees. Lastly, in order to make the right hiring decision, you need to measure your success. Recruitment analytics are really, really important to scale your hiring. Some basics to measure are, first of all, your sourcing activities and strategy. Where are most candidates coming from? Where do most successful hires come from? What are my reply rates, the positives, the negatives, reasoning? Are my response rates higher in one region in comparison to the other? So measuring your sourcing activities can help you to attract and target the right candidates at the right time in the right place. Next to that, it's important to measure the success of your recruitment process. So what are your conversion rates? Where do we lose candidates along the way? This can give you insights in the performance of your interviews and if you need to change something to make it better. So make sure you do this on a regular basis so you can pivot quickly if change is needed. And another extremely important thing to measure is your offer acceptance and decline rates. This can give you more insights in what the market pays and if your organization offers competitive packages or not. And the last important basic thing to measure is your candidate experience. So if you implement a candidate survey, it gives a lot of insights and feedback on how you can improve your process. So make sure it's measurable and set clear objectives on what you want to achieve. But again, you can measure so many different things, but it's important to make sure you have the basics right and from there scale. So as you maybe already can hear, there is so much you can implement and improve, and there's too much to do if your organization is going through high growth. So important for you to remember is that you don't have to do all this alone, because that wouldn't even be possible. So therefore, my lesson learned number 3 is you're in this together, partner with the business. So by real skill, you need all hands on deck. So building a hiring culture is key. And this means that every person in the company understands the importance of hiring and the importance of making the right hiring decisions. So if you are working in an organization where hiring isn't a priority yet, the process of building such a hiring culture often starts with convincing the senior leadership team. What are the benefits of hiring the right people? Make sure they understand the positive impact on the performance and also the positive impact on the business results. So what are other things to think of when building a hiring culture? The first thing that is important is to make sure that all of your employees are recruiters. Make sure they are constantly hiring for you. In the bar, the gym, on a friend's birthday, or a conference they attend, word of mouth is a very powerful tool to generate leads and get candidates excited about your organization. And next to that, sourcing sprints with the business or launching interesting referral campaigns can also help. In any organization I've worked for in the past, the best quality candidates come through direct sourcing and referrals. So make sure you are really kind of like on top of this. You can launch kind of like interesting referral campaigns where employees get referral bonuses for every hire. But if you don't have the budget to pay out those referral bonuses, there are other creative things to think of. To give you an example is that at Improbable, people were granted a form of credits for referrals. And employees could exchange those credits to improve the office or to spend on team outings. Anything related to improving current processes, office space, or team collaboration was allowed here. So at some point, we had like one engineer who referred so many people and earned so many credits that he decided to buy a massage chair in the office. And I can tell you, not much work got done after the first week that chair arrived in the office. So another point I want to highlight here, when building a hiring culture, it's important to reward your interviewers. So you can do this in various different ways, by making it part of their targets or by implementing a prestige program like a bar raiser or moderator program. At Uber, for example, we implemented at some point a moderator program. So this was a competitive program where people could apply for. And a moderator is someone who is not part of the interview process, but leads to the brief session to make sure to reduce bias in our decision making. Another thing that might work as well when creating hiring culture is to give interviewers something in return. So at my time at Facebook, we had a period where engineers received a small Lego piece every time they conducted an interview or when they finished an interview training. So you could definitely notice walking around in the office who did well on the interviewing side and who needed to step up here, because some desks even had like whole castles on it. So it definitely created some kind of like buzz of people who wanted to get more involved in interviewing. Lastly, a TABP is not only a name. It is someone who partners with the business and it goes both ways. So in any organization, it's important to have close relationships with your hiring managers. Hiring managers play a crucial role in helping setting up processes, helping to create interviewer guides, and so on. Important here is that you as a TABP makes it clear on what you expect from those hiring managers. Make sure you manage expectations and ask for help if needed. Remember, when scaling your organization so rapidly, you are in this together and you don't have to do it alone. So having talked about creating a hiring culture, partnering with your hiring managers, it's also important eventually to provide them with the right information, which brings me to my lesson learned number 4. Stay on top of the market. As you all may have noticed, something changed at the start of 2021 in the tech market. Last year was a big year if you look at funding that moved into Europe. It looked like VCs were just like splashing money left, right, and center. And looking into the final numbers, that was definitely the case. So last year, the overall funding in Europe was over 110 billion. And this was more than double the amount than the year before in 2020. But what did this mean? So every organization wanted to hire a lot of people, and more specifically, a lot of engineers. Never before there was such a demand in the business to get those people in. So you need to understand what this means for your organization. How is your organization going to navigate through such a competitive market where everyone is on the hunt for the same people with the same profile? I still remember kind of like the first month of last year that we lost so many candidates at some point due to speed, due to having multiple offers, and people came with like crazy salary expectations. So how, as an organization, are you going to scale your tech teams or your teams in general in such a competitive market and a fast-changing industry? Are you going to offer them a 4-day work week instead of increasing all your employees' salaries? Are you going to work fully remote? Do you implement a hybrid model? So at Molly, we worked a lot on our total rewards in order to keep up with the market. We needed to scale our team so quickly, so we needed to pivot quickly here as well. So what is key to keep in mind when working on rewards is that everyone is different and wants different things. So try to be flexible in what you offer your employees in terms of benefits and give them options. For example, if you as an organization offer a gym membership and the engineer that you would like to hire is not really the sporty spice, you might want to give them the option to something else to get them over the line eventually. So therefore, Molly is giving employees a general well-being budget that anyone can use how they like on their well-being. So you can either use it for gym membership or even to trim your beard or do something else, for example. So important to think here is how you set yourself apart from others and why people want to join your organization. So next to so much funding, the market also became very competitive due to the fact that many more organizations started to hire globally. But this global approach to hiring also generates a lot of opportunities. There is enough talent available in the world, but we need to find creative ways in order to reach that talent eventually. How are we going to find people in parts of the world that is usually not our first to go to? Think of people, for example, in disadvantaged regions in the world. How, as an organization, are you going to reach that group? And more importantly, how are you going to set them up for success during the process? So to give you an example on how to help them through the hiring process is that during my time at Uber, we implemented an advocacy program. And this program was designed to help candidates gain confidence throughout the interview process. So most often, candidates were from underrepresented groups or people who didn't have an educational background or the experience in top tech companies. The advocate was a selected person from the business and then from another part of the business that wasn't involved in the hiring process. And they were having informal meetings with the candidates along the way to help them gain confidence. However, candidates still needed to pass the interview process in order to get a job. But how can we make sure that we already engage with the talent before the formal interview process? Well, coding academies and trainings like the Makers Academy, for example, in London, are successful in their programs. Most often these companies provide a 12-week bootcamp where people from non-technical backgrounds get an engineering course. And after those 12 weeks, most often they get a junior engineering position in any tech companies. However, most of these programs have a price tag. So in order to navigate through this competitive market, will your organization be in a position to design such a program yourself? Those candidates might be the future leaders of your company. So think of creative ways on how you can react to these market developments. Is it flexible benefits? Is it internal academies? Or is it something else? Again, every organization is different, but also in a different stage. And you as a TABP need to collaborate with the business to come to innovative ways in order to be successful in scaling your company eventually. Yeah, if you think I haven't done this already during this presentation, my last and fifth learning is to over-communicate. And no worries, I will keep this one short and spicy. So when scaling rapidly, it involves a lot of constant changes, especially in COVID times while working from home, communication became even more important than we initially thought. So even the smallest changes confuse people and can have a negative impact on your relationship with the hiring manager, but also your quality of hire, candidate experience. Therefore, it's crucial to have a regular cadence in updating the business on any changes. What is important again is to first evaluate your current communication channels, what tools are you using and how you use them. Think of who needs to get updated about what. And most often the whole organization is not really interested in everyone's individual pipelines, for example. Well, I hope at least not. So what we implemented in the tech TA team at Molly is that every TABP has weekly meetings with their hiring managers. And in that meeting, they dive deeper into conversions, priorities, sourcing strategies, and capacity. And next to that, we send out weekly reports to the tech leadership team regarding the hiring plan, priorities, and where we are trending against the plan. And what works really well for us is that we update any major changes on our roadmap or in our processes during the bi-weekly tech all-hands meeting. So this really helps to create alignment across both the product and the engineering department and make sure that everyone is aware of these updates. However, what I've learned is that verbal communication often is not enough. So if you announce any major updates, changes in the roadmap or processes, you need to document those changes. And please make sure that the whole company has easy access to that documentation and can find it back. So tools can really help you out with that. So at Molly, we use different tools like, well, Slack, Confluence, Blogin. And sometimes I even use all these three things to communicate important messages to make sure that no one misses it. And the moment that engineers came to us to tell they already had seen our new interview process several times, we knew that we did very well here. But again, every organization is different and uses different tools. But what is important is to have a constant feedback loop to figure out if your updates are still useful for the business and if you are using the right cadence and channels to deliver those messages. As mentioned before, things can change so quickly, so make sure that you are up to date there. So, long story long, my lessons learned while scaling organizations are, first, build the fundamentals. Secondly, don't be a perfectionist. Everyone makes mistakes. Three, you're in this together, so partner with the business. Four, stay on top of the market. And five, over communicate. Remember, everyone can do this. You just need to go, and don't forget to have fun along the way and enjoy the journey as well. Thank you all for listening in. And as mentioned at the beginning of the presentation, these were just the tip of the iceberg from all my learnings. And I'm sure a lot of you also have your own learnings. So I would love to open the floor for any questions or any other learnings that people would like to share.
Awesome. Tamar, so many gems. Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
before we get to the in-depth content questions, is this you on the surfboard?
This is me next month on the surfboard. No, it's not me, unfortunately.
I happen to know that you're a big surfer, so this is not you, huh? amazing. So we definitely had some questions in the chat, guys. The chat is open, so please, you know, type in your questions in the chat. Tamar, so in no particular order, in that sense, who's training the interviewers at Molly?
Yeah. So we created kind of like an online training program for interviewer training 1.0. So that are the basics. So they go through kind of like the structure of an interview, how to open interviews, and then what is behavioral questions, how to ask situational questions, and then the legal implications. But unconscious bias training owns kind of like the tech TA team or the TA team in general at the moment. So we are training all the employees every month. It's a very kind of like competitive training. So it's most often fully booked. We do that on a monthly basis. So we run that ourselves as TAs, TABPs.
Oh, wow. Cool. Can you stop sharing the screen so we get...
Sure.
Yeah. Question from Sarah, if I pronounce her name correctly. Do you have any good references to stay on top of the market?
Yeah, I subscribe myself. Yeah, you have like a lot of websites, right, where you can stay on top of the market. But I subscribe myself to Sifted, which is always kind of like have a good insight into market developments and
Sifted
new investments.
Right?
Sorry?
Sifted.eu, right?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. You have TechCrunch?
Yeah.
Crunchbase?
Yeah.
And these are mainly kind of like my go-tos. But also what I also would advise, and what I also do quite often, is to kind of like speak with peers or with other people in the industry who work at different companies. This really helps me also to get more insights into their problems or they work against, because it's super competitive, right? So I often kind of like reach out to kind of like my peers or other people in the industry to exchange ideas and to also get to know more about how they run their recruitment function.
Herbert asked the question, how do you keep your hiring managers accountable on feedback and on timelines, especially going from 150 to 700 in a year and a half? I mean, this all sounds great, right? But the reality often is harsher. How do you do that?
it's a very good question. But what is super important is to, again, kind of like communicate. So get buy-in from the senior leadership team on SLAs and show them the numbers all the time. So I think data is really important, and specifically when talking with engineers, to tell your story. So if we kind of like need to hire these 100 engineers, it means so much interviewer hours, and the time to hire really is kind of like increasing if you don't upload your feedback on time. Plus, we might have the possibility to lose candidates along the way, because as you all know, the market is super competitive. So speed is more important than ever. So if they don't get their scorecards in on time, then we might lose candidates. What we also implemented at Molly is to we have debrief sessions. So in those sessions, we run them after they did an interviewer loop, and we do that 24 hours after. So there we discuss all the feedback, and they need to kind of like submit their feedback before those meetings. So this allows us to have a really short feedback loop and to discuss the feedback during those debrief sessions as well, in order to keep the speed in the process. But again, sometimes like there are some persons who don't upload their scorecards. You always have them, right? But it's good to kind of like constantly change and then show them eventually the data on like why it's so important, because they need to put even more effort into interviewing if we lose more candidates along the way.
No, that makes a lot of sense. What percentage of hires come from referrals at Molly? Do you know?
Yeah. So we have a split in between between the 25% referrals, and then also around that 25-30% sourced. And then we have a other bucket of like the 30% through direct applicants. We use some agency, it's around 25-30%.
That's very very good. And do you have an internal system to really cultivate that, to like, you know, keep people engaged? Often it's in the beginning and then it dies off.
We always kind of like have a set seat at the onboarding, so then everyone knows kind of like how to refer people. And we send out a newsletter, and this is kind of like for products and engineering in general every month. And then we have kind of like the top priority rule. So if everyone kind of like can refer people to those, but it's quite often, because people get at Molly, we have the luxury that we can pay out bonuses, referral bonuses. So everyone is quite motivated, obviously, to get a little bit more money at the end of the month.
Okay, that helps. And people like to work for you guys, right?
Yeah, that is also. Yeah, and people refer friends because they really like it, right? So that is also kind of like why we get so many many referrals in.
Yeah, I think Michelle asked a good question as well. Do you have a specific compensation specialist at Molly? Do you discuss those terms with your TA team?
To create the compensation packages?
Yeah.
So we have a whole kind of like comp and ben department who are involved in creating kind of like those compensation packages. But the market is moving so quickly at the moment that we need to stay on top, because at some point, like if you reach a certain percent of offer declines based on kind of like compensation, you're already behind. And most of the time as recruiters, you're the first one to know. So it's really good to have like short communication line as well with HR, and then with specifically comp and ben. and give them market insights into these numbers in order to pivot quickly and make sure that you can scale. Because if you have like a lot of offer declines based on comp and ban for 6 months, you're too late, because then you won't be able to scale the company. So you do definitely have a comp and ban department, but like most often, it TA is driving kind of like those conversations specifically on the tech side.
Yeah. Sarah asked the question, do you hire remotely?
No. We are, no, we have 8 offices spread over over Europe, and we're going to move to a hybrid model. So reason why we chose that, because there are multiple options, right? Remote is definitely one of them as well, is that due to COVID times, interpersonal relations turned out to be more important than we initially thought. So people really miss kind of like the office place. We did like a Great Place to Work survey, and people really miss the office. That was the number one thing that people loved about Molly, whilst the office was already closed for a year. So the majority of the people, right? Because there will always be some who love to work remote. Yeah. But we also experience kind of like these interpersonal relationships are super important, but also the creative processes like brainstorming and stuff like that don't happen that well online. So at the moment, we want to kind of like redesign kind of like our office space. Of course, now it's the office is closed due to the current restrictions. But if we're going back, kind of like to really think kind of like, okay, how am I going to spend my time in the office? We want to create more of a co-working space so you can meet with different stakeholders, other people in the business, and how am I using my time at home eventually?
Okay, that makes a lot of sense. Multiple people asked the software you use to train your interviewers. What's the platform that you use?
We train them ourselves. We train them ourselves, and then we have e-learning. We just have a Google slide deck actually for the unconscious bias training. So we designed it all ourselves.
Yeah.
We use Google Slides.
Okay.
But it's definitely a good point. We now have our first L&D person in the company who is going to be responsible for setting up kind of like the whole learning and development curve. And then we definitely need to automate some of these trainings better. And then we will definitely use a platform. But at the moment, it's just like Google Slides what we are using.
Yeah. Chiasa, again, I hope I pronounced the name correctly, asked an interesting question. She says, working in fintech, you often see white men on C-level positions. What's the percentage of females in your management team, and how do you make sure you hire diverse senior talent?
Yeah, that is, I totally agree with that. When I joined, specifically in tech, it was, we had like, I think, two female engineers. So it was a huge kind of like focus. So the most important thing to think of when just like hiring for diversity, and indeed I do agree with you, is mainly kind of like in tech and also fintech, male, female, because we have a lot of international people working for Molly, a lot of different nationalities. And what we did is to kind of like look into the current state. And that was kind of like very low. I think 1 or 2% was female in our engineering teams. And then set like clear targets with the team or where you want to be. So eventually this year, it's in everyone's DNA to kind of like search for kind of like diverse talent. So in leadership positions in engineering, like from every engineering manager and up that we hired, 30% was female.
Yeah.
And from all the engineers that we hired, like 13% was female. So we made a huge step in this. And then we're going to do the same exercise at the moment. So we're going to kind of like see what is the current state of the teams, like how many females, how many nationalities, where do we need to kind of like grow, and then where do we want to be end of 2022, and then set expectations with hiring managers, because it can take longer to hire that female for that position instead of a male. And of course you need to do that. You need to make the best kind of like fit eventually. But again, it's expectation managing. And if it's not a focus, you're already behind. So it needs to be kind of like in everything we're doing, you have to need to have diverse panels, but also, of course, kind of like have an inclusive culture in order to make sure that females stick to the company and not leave at the end.
Often overlooked by some companies. Do you have any specific strategies how you do that?
Yeah. we have dedicated kind of like sourcing strategies around that. But we also, this year, will be kind of like big on employer branding and more kind of like DEI projects internally as well. So for now, it's kind of like mainly sourcing and some kind of like posts on diversity, but also females at Molly eventually. But we want to build on that and really go big more on employer branding, but also kind of like our sourcing strategies.
Yeah. Jasa Mili asks, are you willing to pay more if you have a diverse candidate for a certain position?
No, we have like set salary bands, so it's more kind of like the skills that are coming in. So we are tied to kind of like certain bandings, right? And we want to make it equal for everyone. So yeah, we're limited to those. Yeah.
Yeah, no, that makes a lot of sense. And some Kolb asks, what is the best source of hire to enhance the conversion rate at Molly?
Referrals. Yeah. I think really kind of like the best quality candidates come kind of like through referrals, and then specifically, for engineering.
Okay. Yeah.
After that, it will be sourced candidates as well. I think the conversion rate from direct applications is very low. Yeah. Specifically, if you look at engineering, a product is a bit higher. Mainly referrals, and then after that sourcing.
What do you see as the main reason why direct applicants that's relatively low?
Yeah, I think it's in every company I've worked for, it's quite kind of like low, because like most of the direct applicants are not really kind of like applicable, or they miss kind of like certain level of the technical skill set what we are looking for. So we do definitely hire people through direct applications, but in comparison to referrals and source candidates, that number is low.
Yeah. Michelle asked an interesting question. For which positions do you use external agencies or external partners?
Yeah, most often for really kind of like senior positions, so VP level and up. Last year, we utilized a little bit more agencies also for the really niche roles where we didn't have time ourselves to source for or to have the manpower, because it's always kind of like building a team, delivering for the business, and they want people yesterday. The team is not staffed to deliver on everything, we need to make choices. And it most often it takes so much time to find like one specific, for example, kind of like principal security engineer instead of kind of like SRE developers. So for VP level and up, and then for these niche roles.
Yeah, that makes sense. Bishnu, again, forgive me if I'm wrong, Bishnu, name. I have a tendency to butcher names, so I'm doing very well with it. What's your suggestion for companies who have an average salary, but you know, they still have a great culture, but considering the current candidate market, yeah, what's your advice? How do you deal with that?
Yeah, I think what Molly also did really well in the beginning when we were really small is employer branding. So you can attract like loads of people from like big companies if you have like medium kind of like comp packages which you can offer, but your employer brand says everything. So go into kind of like the live ads at your company, and then really kind of like make sure that people feel the authenticity of the company. I think like if you look at employer brand, it doesn't need to be kind of like fake, but it needs to be authentic. So what as a company do you want to be perceived by your candidates? And then you can reach a lot in terms of that. So think of kind of like the challenges the company has, because most often kind of like, to be honest, like salary is important, but the most important thing for people why they join a company is people and culture. And then salary comes basically second, unless you're just like on such a high salary that doesn't matter and that you work 24/7 and then retire. But people and culture comes first. So how are you going to market that to the outside world in order to attract those people? So what do you want to be? Who do you want to attract? And how are you going to market that in your employer brand? So your employee value proposition is really important and key here.
Yeah, Yeah. That's a very, very, very good point. Question from, I think it was Michelle again. No, Yuma actually asked this. What are the global expansion plans for Molly? And how will it impact your hiring? Are you guys still like doubling in size or tripling in size? So tell us, what does the 2022 look like for Molly?
Yeah, so we launched the UK market end of last year. So we're going to build on that. And for now, we are planning to build the fundamentals and basics first in order to scale. So the plan is to eventually we want to like kind of like go to something where we can launch multiple countries in a year, but we're not kind of like there yet. So we're indeed going to double the size again of the people in Molly. This is also the thing what I like the most, right? Because now they say this, but I know already kind of like how this will go halfway through the year, because then the plans will change again, and then it's we're all hands a deck again scale even further. But eventually our mission is to become the most loved financial services provider for small to medium sized businesses in the world. That says already enough also about our expansion plans.
Sounds very ambitious. I love it. Sam asks, what are your thoughts about sharing salary in a job advert? In his particular case, he works for a company and they refuse to do it, even though he really believes in transparency. What's your general take on that?
Yeah, it's a good question, because like some companies are indeed kind of like very public about their salary. So there are pros and cons about making it public, right? Because like at some parts of the business, maybe your operations side is a lower salary than the engineering department. It's a very good question. I need to kind of like think about it. We don't have it like publicly listed, because also it changes so often, and we have like strict reasons also why we don't do that. But it's most often kind of like around like total compensation as well, right? So it's a good question, and I need to think about it. So if it's possible, I will get back to you on this.
Awesome. I'll keep your word on that one. Hey, and then last question of today from Chaza. What do you think will be the biggest challenge in talent acquisition in 2022?
Yeah, I think the biggest challenge, because last year it was so much and Molly on building and filling these roles. So the coming year, it's again kind of like make sure that we grow more sustainable, that we really kind of like go big on employer brand for tech and diversity. Reporting remains kind of like an issue, as mentioned, kind of like the moment that I don't make any mistakes in these calculations for the engineering leadership team, I will eat my shoe. So that will be kind of like a main thing. And again, kind of like it's to stay on top of the market, because like last year was just like crazy. I remember Adrian us speaking in January last year and like, well, what happened? This year I want to be kind of like that, be like upfront instead of like being behind all the time. So that is also, I think, a challenge. I think kind of like the challenge will remain kind of like the competitive market, how you're going to navigate through it. We really want to build our tech brand, get our name out there also more in terms of engineering. I think Molly has a great kind of like employer brand in general, but there's not so much to find on like tech blogs and those things. So I think it's super important also in order to attract those people to just like show more kind of like what things on the technical side we are doing. I think that is really important and key to skill and grow. And besides that, to kind of like grow the team. And I think those are the most important. I'm really excited about this year again as well.
I love it. You're absolutely glowing. Your energy is radiating. Tamar, full hour. Thank you so much. Time flew by. So many wisdom and so many gems that people can take home. Tamar, what's the best way for people to connect with you? Is it LinkedIn or yeah?
Yeah, everyone can connect with me on LinkedIn. And do feel free kind of like to ask any questions if anyone has any remaining questions to me on LinkedIn.
Amazing. Tamar, again, thank you so much for being present today, for kicking off the year 2022 off to a right start. Super happy to have you. Guys, next week we have a different speaker after Lindsay and Tamar talking about hypergrowth and like really getting the hands-on and operational experience of what it's like. We're going to switch gears a little bit. We're going to talk about candidate experience. Lars van Vieren is the CEO and founder of Start. He works for companies like Klarna, Twilio, Coca-Cola. And what they do with their software is they measure candidate experience. And he's not going to promote his software. No, he's actually going to share the learnings of how do you create an optimal candidate experience throughout your hiring process. He has a great view of what's going on in the market. He works for tons of very well-known companies and helps them to create an optimal candidate experience. Guys, thank you so much for being present today. Thank you so much for the interaction in the chat. It was a very dynamic conversation. And please come and join us again next week. Tamar, once again, thank you so much. Have a wonderful evening.
Thank you, everyone. Have a lovely evening.
Bye, guys.